Okay. We're going to talk about doing tidal current calculations and define what the actual tidal current, the horizontal motion of water, is doing in any particular harbor at any particular time. A lot of you guys work up in the northern areas where you get in and they have some very treacherous inlets with currents that if you weren't planning on it and coming in at the right time or trying to make a landing at the dock at a slack water, you might not be able to do so at all. Might be a good reason for doing these things. Some of you I know deal with this on a day-by-day basis. You get around here down south, currents are pretty minimal. And you usually don't have to worry about it too much. Okay. So some of you may find some good realistic need for this, some of you not. You all have a form. Looks similar to what we have up here on the board. Again, like tide table calculations for testing, for master's licenses and mate's licenses, you cannot use these forms on the test. Okay. Use the form to get you organized so you know what you're doing. Then after that, you're going to have to get yourself on a piece of paper, learn how to do them without the forms. Coast Guard's idea of that is that if you know how to do it without a form, you really know how to do it. And they're testing you on your proficiency. Now, after you get a license, they know you're going to go back and use forms. It just makes it so much easier for you. They want to test you in the hardest possible method that they can on that type of thing. Okay. So for organizing it and understanding what you got going, this would be the easy way to get into it. We have, like tides, when we talk about currents, subordinate stations and reference stations. Just like the tide tables, when you're trying to find out what the current is in a particular place, you have to base it on somebody else's currents, unless you're at that reference station. Reference station is those set of numbers that you would use to calculate everybody else's current in the area. Okay. So when they ask you, in this case we're going to use a question that talks about Port Morris, New York. That's our substation, where we really want to know the condition of the current. All right. So do plug that in on your form so that you can keep track of it. We're going to be dealing with a question just for practice of May the 13th, 1983. The time that we're looking to determine what the velocity and direction of the current would be is a time of 11:35 DST.
That's 10:35.
Okay, 11:35 DST. DST standing for daylight savings time. They may also write it as let's just deal with daylight savings time, which is zone. Time zone plus 4. It may be interesting to you or important. When you see this on a test, it'll say D plus 4 zone description, ZD. When you see that and you're dealing with an area on the eastern coastline where our normal standard time would be a zone description of plus 5, to go to daylight time, all we do on our clocks in the United States is turn them back an hour, artificially change our time, the time position of the sun and the moon, which affect the tidal currents and the tides, is not changing that hour. The whole world doesn't back up an hour, we just roll our clocks forward and backwards. Okay. The books, tide tables and tidal current tables, are written in standard times. Eastern Standard Time, Central Standard Time, Pacific Standard Time, wherever zone you happen to be in or dealing with is written in a standard time. So if you're at the time of year where in the United States we deal with a daylight time and you say, I want to know, I'm going into Port Morris at 11:35 by my watch, that is really 10:35 standard time. To correct from daylight to standard, all you do is subtract the hour, giving us a corrected time of 10:35 Eastern Standard Time, which would have a zone description of plus 5 instead of plus 4. All right. So when you calculate something like this, you must convert that to standard and use that as the desired time instead of the daylight time. Yes?
Are You say like New York's on Eastern Standard, but if they give you a daylight time, then you go to, you use that time out the book, right? You wouldn't use Eastern Standard.
No, you always have to convert your desired times to standard time. You have Eastern Standard and you have Eastern Daylight. Okay, which is the same thing as saying daylight savings time for that zone. All right, they could have used EDT up here, which is another way they put it, which would be Eastern Daylight Time, which is the same thing as daylight savings time, just a different way of saying it. So you're in the Eastern time zone, but we're working on daylight time instead of standard time. And we must convert that to a standard time before we can use that in our tide and current tables, because they don't take into consideration that time shift. The books are written standard time for the whole year, but half of the year we deal with a daylight time. Okay. Anytime you have to deal with that, must correct to standard. Whether it's Central Standard, Eastern Standard, Pacific Standard, it doesn't matter. Because the books are set up in zone, but they're not set up in daylight time. So that's the first thing you would want to do. Okay. Once you've gotten past that point and you got your form started, you know what you're looking for. The tide tables that we're using here, that you'll be using, copy of the government publication. Looks like this. You got to be very careful when you go to pick up a book. The covers for a tide table and tidal current tables look almost identically the same. You have to read up here where it says tidal current tables. The other book would say tide tables. Current is the horizontal motion of water, not referring to the rise and fall of the water. Okay? Take a look at your books. Like the tide tables, they have three tables involved, table 1, 2, and 3. Table 1 gives you your reference station currents, which we have not determined for Port Morris yet. Reference station means those currents that everybody else calculates off of. You turn back a little farther in the book, you find something laid out in a different direction, like this. At the top it says, Table 2, Current Differences and Other Constants. Just so very similar to Table 2. In the tide book it gives you the time differences and the velocity differences that you're going to need to correct with. A little farther back in the book, right behind Table 2 on page 190, you have a single sheet page that is Table 3. This gives you your correction factor that you're going to need to apply to your nearest current velocity to correct with. All the work we are doing to get these numbers here is just so that we can go into this table and get our correction factor. Okay. First thing you're going to do is to look up in the index Port Morris, New York, and get a four-digit reference number. It's not a page number. So everybody look up Port Morris right now. Come up with a number in there in the index, which you'd plug over here on your form or anywhere else on your piece of paper just to keep track of. 3106. And now that is a Table 2 reference number found in column 1 on Table 2. So what we need to do at this point is to go into the book. Bend the book from the back forward, easiest way to deal with it, until you find a set of pages laid out like this. Table 2. This number 3106 you'd find in the left-hand column of that page. They're all in numerical order from 1 to 3 or 4,000 in this case. Spin through it, find 3106. Take a pencil, straight edge, lay it across there so you don't read the wrong numbers as you're going through. One of the biggest mistakes you can get into. Now, when you find 3106, get your straight edge lined up and take a look at the available information at the top of the sheet. The first column tells you where it's at. The second column you have is latitude and longitude, and we're generally, for doing these type of corrections, not all that worried about if we're exactly at that location. The third and fourth columns across are your time differences. These are very important This is primarily what we're using this table for, to find out how much time delay or advance from our reference station currents we're going to be dealing with. At the top of the sheet, it says minimum before a flood. A minimum, and also on your form, says minimum, which is, in fact, and it does not say it in the book right up at the top, but if you read in the details, it does. A minimum before a current is actually slack water. So when they say minimum before a flood or minimum before an ebb, they're talking about slack water. You notice that in the book, as well as on the table, we have two slack waters that we deal with. One of them that falls before a flood, and one of them that falls before an ebb. Now let's talk about what kind of currents we have in a day. When the water is coming inland and going upstream, theoretically, what do we call that type of a current?
Flood.
That's a flood current, flooding in. When it gets to full high tide and that current stops, what do we call that lack of horizontal motion?
Slack.
Then it turns around and starts going downstream or offshore, and we call that an ebb current, ebbing out or flooding in. When it gets to the bottom all the way out and stops, we have another slack water again before it changes and comes back in again. So for every rise and fall, you got one current that comes in, another current that comes out, and in between each current, you must have a slack water. It's got to stop before it changes directions. So you would have theoretically a slack, then a flood, then a slack, then an ebb, then a slack, then a flood, and whatever. You should always have a slack water between each direction change. Okay. What we have here are two different correction factors, because table two are our time differences, that we would apply. If the slack water we're trying to correct falls before a flood, we'd use this correction factor. If the slack water fell before an ebb, we'd use this one. And then we have one correction for maximum floods and one correction for maximum ebbs. Okay, so you actually got four different correction factors. You got to be very careful that when you are correcting those times that you pick the right correction factor, because they're all different. You don't start with the right numbers, you can't come out with the right answer. Okay. Looking at this right out of your book, let's start plugging in some numbers here. At the top where it says minimum before a flood, remember that minimum means slack water. Right on your form, it says minus 7 minutes. So write it in there. Next one across is your maximum flood correction. In this case, we have a minus 32 minutes that we are going to subtract from the numbers we get. The next one across that you see is a minimum before an ebb, which again means slack water. It says add 20 minutes. And the last one down, which is our full ebb correction, says plus 003 minutes. Those are all our time corrections that we're going to have to deal with. Now, following across the top of the page, there's two other bits of information that's very important to us. The next column across says speed ratios. A speed ratio basically tells you what percentage of the velocity of the current would make it to the point you're dealing with. Right. This case, we're going to end up using
0.4.
We're going to use Hellgate's currents as a reference station, which we'll get to in a minute how you find that. Hellgate's in one area. Way up the creek, you're going to get to Port Morris. There is going to be some velocity decrease or increase involved there as well. You're not going to have the full velocity up the creek. So what this does is gives you a percentage of Hellgate's current, velocity of its current, that would apply to Port Morris. Speed ratios, the word ratio for our purposes would mean a multiplication problem, a ratio problem. You notice that in the speed ratio column at the top, you have a flood ratio and an ebb ratio. Generally, they are different. Sometimes they're the same number, but to be safe, you want to write both of them down. In this case, the ratio is 0.4 for the flood and also 0.4 for the ebb. That doesn't work out that way in most cases. Sure you do. Sure you do. Now, Right here.
Speed ratio.
See that? Speed ratio?
Right there.
Oh. Flooding it out. Now, we need another thing. We need to know which way the direction, the number of degrees that the current flows in or out as a true course. Looking in your book, there are a couple of extra columns. At the top, it says the average speeds and directions. Then we have four separate columns. One says minimum before a flood. What is a minimum?
Slack.
It's a slack water. Should a slack water have any direction? Should it have any velocity?
No.
No, if you look at that column, you got nothing but zeros all the way down that column. And no directions indicated. Then you hit the maximum flood direction and the average velocity. We're never interested in its average velocity, only the direction in which it's flowing. Okay. So slide down there, and you will find that it has in flood direction 0.45 degrees. And anytime we talk about current, that's always true course. Next column over says minimum before an ebb. Again, a minimum is a slack, so it should be zeros all the way down the column, which it is. Last column across gives you maximum ebb, velocity in degrees. We want to go for just this direction and find it to be about 220. We'll use these later on with the answer. When they ask you what the velocity is, you'll have calculated it out. When they ask you what the direction is, you will use whichever direction here we're dealing with. Okay. Everybody with me? Okay. Next thing you do, just like you did in your tide tables, when you found that here is your 3106 and these are your time in your time difference column now, where you're reading the numbers, if you slide your finger straight up it to the first thing you find hanging out in the middle that says on so and so, page whatever, in this case is on Hellgate, page 46. Hellgate will be our reference station, that which we are going to have to correct to get Port Morris's. So up here where it says reference station, so you don't forget, plug in Hellgate, page 46, just so you remember where it's at. Remember that the page that they give you always will bring you into January. And if you're not careful, you write down those numbers and really screw it up because you're not dealing with January, we're dealing with May, which will probably be a few pages past that. So everybody find it in the book. Go to page 48, find January, and then start turning pages till you can find May. All right. Should be about page 48.
May the 13th.
May the 13th.
Gotcha. 48.
Okay. This is where the problem comes in interpreting what you are looking at. Everybody go to the top of the page. This is slightly different than your tide tables. At the top of the page, you have the day, which is obviously the left-hand column gives you the date. The next column across where you have all your times listed are just your slack waters. Time of slack water. And those give you all your slacks for the day. The third column in gives you your maximum current. And the fourth column gives you its velocity and its direction by indicating an E for an ebb or an F for a flood. Okay. If you look on the 13th here, the first slot shows us that our first current of the day is not a slack water, but happens to be a 0.036 maximum ebb, 5.1 knot ebb. Okay. What we're going to try to do is take this and take the two columns that we have, the slacks and the maximum velocities, and meld them together so the times are in order, stacked up on top of one another, instead of working from one side to the other. So you got to be careful how you write them down. You would have first at 0.036 a maximum ebb. The next current of the day would have to be what? No, it has to be a slack. We have an ebb, then you got to have a slack, then back to a flood, then back to a slack. So you're bouncing back and forth between those two columns, and you want to write these things down in sequential order, time order, so that you don't have to try to work with it out of the book, which is always confusing. It's not laid out to be real easy to work with.
So you go 0.036, then the 0.405.
Right, back and forth, 36, 405, 659, 1010, 1256, back and forth, one from each column. Remember that all of those in the slack water column have a direction of zero and a velocity of zero. No direction, no velocity for slack waters. Okay. Now let's, we're going to move this thing up, Dave. All right, now what we want to do, we have all our time corrections. We need to utilize these columns. And I'll tell you right off the bat, this form has one flaw in it. And that is this column right here, the time correction column. There is no need to take this, bring it to here. All you're going to do is take another chance of writing it down wrong. So for the purpose of using this, we're not going to use the center column for anything. All right, it's a great idea, it didn't work. Okay.
Worked that right out.
Yeah, just scratch it out. It'll save you a lot of trouble. Okay, over here on the time column, all we want to do is be able to plug in all of those times in order, their velocities, whether it's zero or maximum current, and its direction. And we want to take it out in time order. So the first time of the day that we have listed is what?
0036.
It's a 0036. It's in the slack column, right? Velocity of slack water has to be zero. And over here in the direction column, we'll just put an S.
That's not in the slack column.
It is not in the slack column, okay. What column is it in?
Maximum
what do we got?
Current.
Nothing in the slack column.
You're right. Okay, the first of the day is in the second column over, and it's a 5.1 M. Okay, what's the next one of the day?
0405.
It's got to be a slack, right? So you pop over to the slack column, and the first slack you have is a 0405. Don't shake if you can help. Okay. The velocity of a slack water has to be zero, and we'll put a little S over here for slack. The next thing we're going to happen in the day, after it stops, then what's it going to turn around and go the other direction, right? So what we have next, it would have to be, and it's a 0659, 3.8, and the little F next to that tells you that it is a flood current coming in. Then back and forth, the next one we have is a 1010, zero velocity slack. Then I have a 1256, 4.9 ebb, 1617, zero slack, 1917, 3.8 flood, then back to a slack for the last of the day. 22, 25, zero slack. Now you're looking at it and say, why do we bother doing all of that? Well, you gotta start out with everything. After you get good at this, then you're gonna learn how to eyeball it and say, well, I really only need to deal with maybe these three or these two. And you won't have to write them all down. But it's good practice just to understand what you're dealing with, to be able to go through it and have it so that you don't have to keep referring to the book. You can do this by just picking a number, but you have to go from one section of the book to the other, back and forth, working it out. It's easier if you get it all laid out. Now, what I'm going to have to do is what I have here is a reference station. My reference station is Hellgate. But I don't care what's happening at Hellgate. If Hellgate was what I was looking for, it's already worked out for me. I don't have to do any time corrections at all. I'm looking for Port Morris, which is going to be my substation. So, what we're going to have to do is to take these time corrections and apply them to these times, write them down over here. For the current corrections, as far as velocities go, we take our full velocities. You can't do anything to zero. No matter what you do to zero, it still comes out zero. But our full velocities, we're going to have to use our speed ratios with to get the corrected velocity for Port Morris. Let's do the times first on this. And let's try to save a little bit of time. Let's use a little thought here. What is our desired time?
10:35.
Desired time is 10:35 standard time. Is it important to us what happens at 36 minutes after midnight?
No.
Makes no difference to us, right? look at your time corrections. This is an easy way. Some of them you can't do this too, but this one we look. The best we're doing is either subtracting 32 minutes or adding 20 minutes. So we're never going to be more than a half hour off of what we have over here. We're looking for a desired time of 10:35. We're only interested in what happened just before that and just after 10:35. Take a look down here and say, well, I'm going to be adding or subtracting a half hour on the average. What happens at 6 o'clock is only going to put me to 7 o'clock. That's really not going to do the job for me. I'm looking for an area that my time will fall in between, a couple of them. Get a ballpark. Let's say that chances are we're going to be pretty close to 10:10, one of our numbers that we're going to need. So let's start correcting with the 10:10. Just take it into consideration. If I have a 10:10 time, which happens to be a slack water, you look up here at your correction and say, well, I have two slack waters. I have a slack before an ebb or a slack before a flood. Next thing you have to determine is that slack before an ebb or a flood.
Ebb.
Look right there and you say, hey, that slack's before an ebb. Slack before ebb correction says add 20 minutes to it. 10:30. Make sure you draw that line between the hours and minutes so you don't make the common mistake everybody does carrying 10 instead of 60 minutes. When you got that number, write it straight across in this column over here, and now you've got the corrected time for that slack water. The velocity of slack will never change, it's still zero, and we're going to use S for its direction, though we didn't put in a special column for it. You do need to indicate it. Now that falls 5 minutes before our desired time. If all you were going to do is say, hey, I need to know about what it is, you would say, well, that's 5 minutes after a full slack. It's probably going to be damn near slack water.
Wait a second.
Okay. But for Coast Guard testing, they want exactly to the hundredth what the velocity of the current is, not that it makes a lot of difference. Okay. So let's just play with working this thing out for the whole run. My desired time is going to fall in after 10:30. So I must go down to the next time of the day and correct it as well. I have a 12:56, 4.9 knot ebb. Going for the time first.
You have to add 3 minutes.
12:56 is a full ebb. I come up here and my full ebb correction says add 3 minutes. You don't even have to put that on paper to work that one out, right? Gives a 12:59 corrected. However, I have a 4.9 knot velocity of that current. I must correct that as well. I'm not going to get the whole advantage of that 4.9 knots. So what I'm going to have to do is use my speed ratios. Speed ratio for a flood is 0.4, and speed ratio for an ebb in this case is 0.4. Again, remember that they're not always the same. Don't assume that they are. And all you would have to do there is take the velocity of 4.9 knots and multiply it. Anytime they use the word ratio or factor, it's a multiplication problem. So what we're going to do at that point is take that and multiply it by 0.4 or 0.4. Either way, it doesn't make any difference at all. Okay? Do the multiplication on it.
1.96.
Should come out, working it out, 1.96. Now this is where everybody screws up. Where do you put the decimal point? Well, if you have a calculator, you don't worry about it. You just punch it in, it works out great. Real quick on mathematics and multiplication, to find out where the decimal point goes in your answer, you count the number of places in the problem, not in just any one part of it, but the whole problem that's right at the decimal point. Got one place here and one place here. So I'm going to have to move in my decimal point two places. 1.96 knots is what the full flood current is. And you write it down over here. 1.96. Don't leave any of it out. Don't round it off. And that's an ebb. I'm going to use the whole thing so we can get our answer, and then we round it off when we get our answer. We have done all the correction we have to do. Because I don't care what happens down here at 1900 hours. Makes no difference. I have two times corrected for Port Morris that bracket my desired time of 10:35. Therefore, these are the only numbers that mean anything to me on the sheet anymore. This is unimportant. That's Hellgate's currents. We're not interested in what Hellgate's doing. We only needed to know that to get this. Once we have it, that's obsolete information. Cross it out so you don't go back to it again. Now that you have corrected Port Morris's tides, now all we have to deal with is Table 3, finding out what they want out of the deal. Okay? Hold it there, Dave.
No, we don't have to do that other part.
Okay, to do our Table 3 corrections. Now that we have corrected our tides for Port Morris, we need to deal with Table 3. If you all open your books to that page 190, or whatever Table 3 is lined up on, you can see in the book, without having the form whatsoever, that the information here is the same information that's listed here. So you really don't need this form. It's just a little crutch to get you rolling. Once you got it, the form really is not necessary to do these things. Okay. This is a two-part Table 3 form. You don't use both parts together. It's either the top half or the bottom half that you use. How do you determine? Right below Table B, there's a little note that says use Table A4 and use Table B4. Let's read that. It says use Table A for all places except those listed below for Table B. Makes sense. Table B used for Hellgate Canal, Cape Cod Canal, Hellgate, Chesapeake, Delaware Canal, and so on. They're not talking about the reference station, the substation, Port Morris. Hellgate is our reference station. Hellgate is listed here. So we're going to have to use for this calculation Table B. You always have to look at that before you go into this table so that you use the right one. If you use the wrong one, they give you different numbers, definitely. Okay. Now let's analyze the table. A or B has the same two elements in it. At the top of the element, it says interval between slack and maximum current. Again, we're talking time intervals. Over on the left-hand side, it says interval between slack and desired time. With these two numbers, this table will work and you can get your correction factor. Let's look at our form and see what we have listed up here. First thing we need is the time interval between slack and desired time. Not any slack water. The slack water that we're dealing with.
5 minutes.
Okay. If we have a desired time of 10:35, and we have a slack water of 10:30, that one ought to be real easy to do, right? 5 minutes difference between our slack water and our desired time. So just plug that in there. 5 minutes. The next one I ask you for, interval between the slack water we're dealing with and the maximum current we're dealing with. Well, we only have one slack and one max current. So they want to know how much time is between those two numbers. Subtract the little one from the big one. 30 from 59 is going to leave me 29, and 10 from 12 is going to be 2 hours and 29 minutes. Plug that in. Now we're really done. The next question on the form is something that doesn't really need to be there. Anytime we get a correction, we have to correct the nearest velocity. You can't correct zero, it just doesn't correct out to anything else but zero. So you would always apply your correction factor to your nearest velocity, maximum velocity. Just like on the tide tables, we applied our height correction to our nearest tide. On current tables, you would apply your correction factor from Table 3 to your maximum velocity nearest to where you're at. Okay? In our case, we only have one maximum velocity. And that's 1.96 knots, period. There's nothing else to deal with or to confuse yourself with. And it happens to be an ebb. And that's just as a reference point. It doesn't mean anything at this time. Now go into Table 3. All right, very similar to the other things that you've done. We're using Table B. We've already determined that. At the top of the page, it says interval, and you always want to start look at both of them. Sorry.
all your dead meat. And I'm gonna give you to him.
All right, ready to try this again? Okay. Look at table three, deal with it. Two different elements. You start at the left-hand side where it says interval between slack and desired time. Obviously, you're not going to find anything that matches you exactly. You want to pick the number that is closest to what you have. We have here, interval between slack and desired time is 5 minutes. So along this column here, take a piece of paper and find the closest thing to 5 minutes. In this case, the lowest thing we have is 20 minutes, which we'll use. Line your piece of paper up across all the way, so it's nice and square. Line it up with 20 here so that it lines up all the way across. Then go to the top of the page, or top of that table that says interval between slack and max current. Look over at our form, we have 2 hours and 29 minutes. This is a little different than what you did with the tide tables because you do use this first column of numbers. Find the closest thing to 229. We have a choice of 220 or 240.
220.
It's got to be 220, right? In that column, if you take your finger and run it right down to your piece of paper, to the baseline that you just created, it will give you your correction factor. And in this case, it's a point or 0.3. And that's all you need table three for.
What if it was 230?
Well, then you would have to say, how bad do I need the answer? Depends. If you're looking for reality, I would say split the difference between the two factors and go with it. If you're looking for a Coast Guard test to get an answer, whichever one works. Okay, because they don't round necessarily consistent with rounding up or rounding down. It's not consistent. Sometimes you have to try both of them and see which one works for you. In this case, we don't have any questions, and 0.3 is a correction factor. Now, what do you do with it? We have the word factor. Like the word ratio, what does that mean to us?
Multiply.
It means multiply. So we take our maximum current velocity that we're nearest to, 1.96, times the correction factor of 0.3. Multiply that out and come up with 588.
0.588.
Well, that's the one to talk about where the point was again. Remember that we have one, two, three places to the right in the problem, so we're going to go three places to the left, getting a velocity corrected of 0.588 knots. For reality, a half a knot probably wouldn't make any difference to you at all in operating, unless you're looking for a slack water, that'd work out right. This times this gives you the velocity, which you might put here, 588 knots. Now, the only other thing we have to determine is what the direction is. This baby here, the one that we calculated and converted, was an ebb current. You look up to the top to your corrections, which we don't have on the board here that you should have. What is the ebb direction?
220.
It's 220 degrees. So anytime we're dealing with the ebb, its direction over here would be 220 degrees. What we have is a velocity of 0.588 knots at 220 degrees. That's its direction. Now you know exactly at 1035, what you're dealing with.
And the reason why you use the ebb is because
I was correcting from an ebb. Right? It's the ebb. I've already slacked at 1035. The direction it'll be going from there on out has got to be an ebb direction until I get to 1259. Then it would stop and change the other direction. So anywhere between these two numbers, it's on an ebb. This is the maximum ebb. It's for top speed. And then it goes downhill again towards the slack.
Same way with your floods.
Same exact way with your floods. You're going from that to a slack, or from the slack to it. All right? That's all there is to it. Ready to try one on your own?
Let's do another one on paper. Would you help me?
Yeah, that's what I say about teaching people to swim. You just throw them overboard. Well, consider yourself thrown overboard. Everybody got one of these sheets here?
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't want it.
Yeah. What we're going to do now is talk about the maximum distance in which you could possibly see a light at sea. All lights are not visible the same distances, that is that they do not have the same candle power or intensity of light. They're all different. The meteorological weather conditions could be perfectly clear, you have unlimited visibility, or you could have a lot of dust, moisture, fog, anything possibly in the air, just particles that would cut down the vision. If you have a real hazy day, it's nice and clear and you can see solid objects a long way, but that haze and that dust particles floating in the air is going to keep the light from filtering through the air. Actually, it's going to absorb some of the light or reflect the light in different directions and not let it go as far in any given direction. So when you look on a chart, and I'm sure all of you have looked on a chart next to a buoy or next to a light, and seen a number that says 12 m or 15 m or 6 m, that is a mileage distance that that light could be theoretically seen based on clear visibility. Now, clear isn't unlimited, but it's just a number that they picked to say this is average or clear visibility. And the normal is considered 10 miles. All of the numbers that you deal with on a chart, you look up visibility, that is based on a 10-mile visibility. Now, it may say 18 miles on a light. You say, well, how can something possibly go 18 miles in 10 miles visibility? Well, that doesn't mean that that's where the visibility stops. That's where clear visibility stops. Light can still go farther than that. Okay? We have a that problem, as well as a problem of the Earth being round. Something that's round, this in fact, well, what we were dealing with, and our vessel was sitting right here, and our point from the bridge, our eye, was say 15 foot above the Earth. We could see in a straight line to the horizon, like that, in either direction, in any direction. If we had a light that was sitting, and this is real exaggerated, but a light that was sitting here, could we see that light? No matter how bright that light was, had unlimited candle power, that light is not going to be able to be seen through the Earth. All right? An example. You can see, if you're standing on a vessel, or anywhere for that matter, out on open flat area, and your eye is 15 foot above the water, you can see the absolute horizon at 4.4 miles away. That is to say, if there was a beer can floating in the water and you had a telescope, that you could see it just at the horizon every once in a while, not more than 4.4 miles away. Okay. Now obviously we all stand out at the beach, you go out on the boat and you look, and hell, you can see a ship out there 25, 30 miles away, no problem. But you're not looking at his waterline. You're looking at something much higher above the surface than his waterline. And you couldn't see that. Now likewise, if another vessel was out there and he was standing 15 foot above the water, if you can see from here to the horizon 4.4 miles away, and he was over here somewhere standing 15 foot, he should be able to see from him to the horizon 4.4 miles away. So both of you are sitting there with a telescope, you ought to be able to see each other bob above the horizon at exactly not more than 8.8 miles away, because this direction you got 4.4 and this direction you got 4.4 miles. Okay, there is a table that is found number one in the light list, and it's right up in the front in about 3 or 4 pages. It states geographic range table, and it tells you at any given height how far you could see. You don't need to know just about yourself. You need to know about the height of the other object because it's looking back at you. Okay? Let's talk about how to figure geographic range first. If you can't see over the curvature of the Earth, does it matter how bright the light is? Okay, it doesn't matter. So first you got to get past that solid object, the curvature of the Earth. Without that, no use looking for the light. If your geographic range is 8.8 miles away and you're 10 miles away from the light, doesn't matter how bright it is, you're not going to see it till you get within 8.8 miles of it. Okay. What we have here, and you should have in front of you, is a blow-up. Put it up on the board. Of what would be in the Coast Pilot. There are two different tables. In Coast Pilot, which is also a reference book that y'all are going to use on a regular basis, in the back of the book there are a number of different tables. And they're labeled on the T pages, standing for table pages. In the back of any Coast Pilot, they're all the same, doesn't matter which area you're using, book 1, 2, 3, 4, so on. The geographic area that the book covers doesn't alter the tables in any way. On page, on most of the Coast Pilots, on page T21, you will find, and they call it a distance visibility of objects at sea, just a little bit different table. The advantage to this, and the disadvantage, opposed to the one in the Coast Pilot, one in the Coast Pilot here only has the distances in feet and in nautical miles. In the light list, you can get yourself in trouble because it has the height of eye in feet, or the height of object in feet, also in meters. And if you're not careful, you might go to the meter column and use that for a height instead of, and get yourself in a little problem. So to be careful, especially when you're dealing with a test, I suggest you use the one in the back of the Coast Pilot, which we had printed on this orange sheet for you. Right. There will be necessity to use the one in the light list if they ask you a light that's visible 16 miles. How far can you see it, or how high is it in meters? You would need to use the meter scale. Okay. Very simply, there's nothing to these calculations. You need to know a couple of things. You need to know the height of eye. How high the observer is looking for the light. Now this is something that you calculate on your vessel, or for a test they always give you the height of eye. We're going to use a number of 15 feet to do this first problem with. You also need to know how high the light is. And for this problem we're going to work one on Chesapeake Light. Chesapeake Light, we have some information to be about 117 foot high. Now, got to be careful here. A lot of people say, well, I'm going to take a shortcut and I'm going to add these two numbers together and then I'm going to go into the tables. You can't do that. You have to go into the table with each individual number and then add them together. All you do, dealing with the table, we've got 15 foot, so you look up in the height column, 15 feet. You go right next to it and it gives you a height, or excuse me, a nautical mileage of 4.4 miles. So then you're going to turn around and just write down 4.4 miles next to 15 feet. Then you go back into that and you look up the height of the light. Now we're dealing with 117 foot, that's an odd number. We've got a choice of 110 or 120. 110 is 12 miles, 120 is 12.6 miles. Might be safe to just split the difference and go with 12.3 or 12.4. All right, 12.4 would be fairly close, good enough for what we're dealing with. 12.4 miles, that light can see the absolute horizon. With those two numbers, those two mileages, you just add them together. Come up with a geographic range between the two of 16.8 miles. Right? The instructions for this are also found right in the light list at the bottom of the table, and it shows you to take the height of the object, its height, get the mileage, the height of the observer, take them, add them together. So really when you're dealing with the test, if you don't remember, right here gives you the diagram to show you how to run it. Right, do what it says. Now.
And light would just be on the horizon when you pick it up.
At 16.8 miles, you should see it just bob over the horizon, absolutely. Now, that is if the light's bright enough to go 16.8 miles. It may not be. So the other factor is, we have to determine how bright the light is, how bad the visibility is, and how far that light can cut through the air. It may be less than 16.8 miles, in which case this is not a good guideline. This is your geographic range, just physical. Even in the daytime, when the light is not on, this is how far away till you ought to be able to see the top of the tower, the lighthouse, or whatever you're dealing with.
Clear visibility.
Okay. And clear, yeah, reasonably good visibility. Over here, what we need to do is deal with a couple of other subjects in definitions. Definition is real important to you. Let me read it to you right out of the book so we don't mess with it. We use three terms. We use the term nominal range, visibility, which makes sense to all of us, and luminous range. Nominal range I like to relate to as being a normal, nominal situation. The definition is, word for word, the maximum distance at which a light can be seen in clear weather. The definition of clear weather for doing light calculations is a meteorological visibility of 10 miles. Regardless of the curvature of the earth, the height of eye, or the height of the light. So it does not take into consideration any of those factors. Just how bright that light is, and theoretically how far you could see it if you were in an airplane, which would not take into consideration the curvature of the earth. Make a little sense? The other definition, luminous range, or how bright far the lumens will go, or that light will project itself. Luminous range is the greatest distance that a light can be seen given its nominal range, whatever the normal is, and the existing meteorological conditions. Nominal is based on 10 miles. Luminous is based on what we really have, more or less than 10 miles. Okay. Three factors. I'll use some little abbreviation. I highly suggest that you use this. Use non for nominal, visibility, and luminous range. We use a little table here. If in fact the nominal range, for an example, was say 24 miles, which Chesapeake Light is, which we've already started, the visibility, if it's given, you have to use it. If you're out there in reality, you're going to have to estimate what it is, and it's not as exact in reality because you're just estimating. Visibility in this case, for the problem is 11 miles, but let's talk about how this works first. Nominal is based on 10 miles, clean air. So if we have, in fact, 10 miles visibility, how far under existing conditions, which luminous range stands for, could we see that light? Nominal is based on 10, and if we have 10, then we should be able to see it the full 24 miles without taking into consideration the curvature of the earth. I like to look at this visibility here as a light filter. Here you have a light, there you are, somewhere in between the visibility gets in your way. Okay? If it's a normal 10-mile visibility, you can see through it, no problem. Now, as that is cut down, this being normal, if in fact the visibility, say for an argument, was 8 miles, 24-mile nominal range, with 10-mile visibility can be seen 24 miles. How about with 8? Less or more than 24? If you have a lower visibility, you're going to see it less than its normal. And it doesn't work proportionately, but let's just say for the sake of argument, maybe it's 20 miles. If we have a greater than 10 visibility, which in many cases we do, say we have 15 miles visibility, nice, clear, clean, high-pressure day. 24, it will go 24 with 10 miles, should go quite a bit farther if we had a 15-mile visibility. Right. So then, if visibility is more than 10, then the luminous range is going to be greater, and maybe we have 30 miles. And these numbers have nothing to do with reality. The idea is the dirtier the air is, the less the light can travel through the air without being absorbed. The cleaner the air is, the farther it can go. And they pick 10 as a medium or normal to base the numbers that they write on the chart. So far, so good? The way that you would get an exact number on this, and again, I highly suggest you use a little formula here so you always plug in what you're dealing with. The nominal range on Chesapeake Light, which we already started here, was 24 miles. The visibility given, for an example, is 11 miles. We want to know how far the luminous range is, or what that light can be seen under the existing 11-mile visibility. And that's what this luminous range diagram, which comes out of the center of the out of the front of the light list, which is right across from the geographic table, right up in the front, first in about four pages. You always find it right here. Now, there have been...
So it's also in the back of the coast pile?
No, this is not in the back of the coast pile. Just the geographic tables. Luminous table only applies to light, so it's only found in the light list.
Okay.
You must be careful for testing those you guys going for master mates licenses not to use any other year book but the 1985 book, which is this bright pink one. All the tests are based on the table found in this book. Every year for the last 4 years, this table has changed. Why it's different every year, I have no idea, but it changes. All right, somebody redoes it, they come up with a different theory. How they work it out, I have no idea. 1985 books you must use when you're dealing with tests. Now, any of them are good enough for reality, because a mile here or there isn't going to make a bit of difference to you. When you get into this table, running through it, you do need yourself something with a nice square edge on it. And they try to show you how to use it. Always go into the bottom with the nominal range. Here's your nominal range listed. That is the numbers across the bottom of the sheet. Along the side of the sheet, we have the luminous range indicated. And these curvy lines that run through the whole center are your visibility curves. Okay, now, it's gotten a little more difficult than it used to be. They used to put the numbers right on the lines and let you have an exact number. Now they have gone to a range within the envelope or the area between being a thin fog or a haze or a light haze or clear visibility. It gets a little difficult to tell exactly what the visibility is. If you notice that number 3 envelope indicates that its light fog is from 0.27 miles to 0.54 miles. That would seem to mean that the bottom line is 2.7 miles and the top line would be 0.27, and the next line was 0.54, about a half. Number 4 goes from 0.54 up to 1.1 at this line. Number 5 envelope, 1.1 up to 2.2 here. From 2.2 up to 5.4, up to 11. This one here is up to 27. Then you're really getting into exceptional weather conditions. Okay. So anytime you're going to work one of these, it probably is best to go through and put the numbers on the lines that apply, because generally speaking, you're going to use a hard number. You're not going to try to split the difference between a couple of miles. But the tests are always going to give you a hard mileage. A common one is 11. Another one is 5.4 miles. Now, to use this to answer this problem here where we had a nominal range of 24, you get yourself a straight edge piece of paper or something, and you locate 24 mile nominal range, which is at the bottom. And that line that runs straight on up. You square up your piece of paper with the corner like this. The next thing you have to deal with is the visibility. They say the visibility is 11 miles. Well, here's your 11 mile curve that runs right above the 7. So what we need to do is slide our piece of paper up until the corner of the sheet is lined up on 11 miles and the edge of your paper is lined up with the 24 mile nominal range. You get here, slide it up to your visibility curve, and then just walk it over here to this corner and read what the nominal range is. In this case, it's approximately 30 miles. Make some sense? All you do is come in from the bottom, 24 miles, go up at a straight edge until the corner of that paper touches the curve, visibility curve you're dealing with, in this case 11, and then read it over, square it off, right angle to the left. You get approximately 30 miles. Okay, now, if we have an existing condition that would allow us to see a light 30 miles, but the geographic conditions only allow us to see that thing 16.8 miles, which one of those is the greatest distance I could possibly see that light, given all of these factors? I can see it 30 miles away in an airplane where the curvature of the Earth had nothing to do with anything. But now, I got a curvature of the Earth that's limiting me to 16.8 miles no matter what I'm dealing with. It was the sun. I could still only see it 16.8 miles. So after working both of these elements, getting your luminous range and your geographic range, now you can tell what the maximum theoretical range of that light is, and it's the lower of the two factors, either luminous or geographic. So if you were to get this question on the test, and some of you will someday, that's the answer to it, not 30. Go ahead.
Okay.